For those of you, and probably most of you, who didn't see my production of The Spring and Fall of Eve Adams, I want to tell you a little bit about this extraordinary woman who, until I found her, was kind of lost. Eve Adams came from Poland in 1925. Excuse me. She came to New York and opened a tea room on McDougal Street. And changed her name to Eve Adams from Chava Zloczower from Malava, Poland. Eve was a Jewish lesbian, writer, promoter of the arts, and her tea room on McDougal Street became a center for the artists and writers in Greenwich Village in the 1920s. And she promoted the early work of Henry Miller when nobody knew who he was. Later of Anais Nin and other later well-known writers, as well as artists, musicians. She had salon evenings at her tea room, but then things changed. And as we know, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Excuse me. And there were citizens groups that formed that decided that they should promote a moral lifestyle in New York City and go after the, quote, bohemians and the perverts and the degenerates and the inverts, and Eve paid the price for that. She had written a book of short stories called Lesbian Love that she printed privately and distributed to her friends. But one of those do-gooders, who actually was, as he called himself, a son of the village, who was against those kike socialist bohemians, was rumored that he was the one who was responsible for Eve's downfall. And what he did was, he got the police to send an undercover policewoman who came three times to the tea room and persisted until Eve finally asked her to go out to the theater and dinner and dancing. And then Eve made the mistake of giving her a copy of the book. Because of that, she was arrested, charged with disorderly conduct, which was the euphemism for being gay or lesbian, and for promoting obscene literature. She spent a year and a half in the women's penitentiary on Blackwell's Island, which is now Roosevelt Island, and was subsequently deported back to Poland. She spent the 1930s in Paris as a bookseller, and if you read any of the collected letters of Henry Miller or Anais Nin, you'll find mentions of Eve Adams and how she was promoting their work that was banned in their own countries. But she was promoting it with English-speaking tourists who then went home and told their friends about these wonderful writers whose work they could not buy at home. When the Nazis invaded, Eve went south to Nice, which was occupied by the Italian army and protected the Jews. But when Italy changed sides, Eve was the German army moved in and Eve was arrested and deported back to Poland, only this time to Auschwitz, where she was murdered on arrival. So this is a little background. But I tried to find a copy of the book. There's a woman upstate who has a copy and won't give it to me or even let me see it, except she scanned the cover and sent it to me. So when I was writing the play, what I did was write stories that I thought kind of captured the feeling of Eve's village and the village scene and the lesbians. So I'm going to read one of the stories. This is the story of Julia and the mole. Every day, except Sunday, Julia would leave her room in Mrs. Battaglia's boarding house on Grand Street and make the long walk to the hat shop on 8th Street. There she spent 12 hours a day, with a half hour for lunch, in the back room sewing ribbons and silk flowers onto ladies' bonnets. Her path to work took her through Washington Square, past the fountain and through the arch. One day, During the ninth year of daily journeys, she noticed a young woman sitting alone on a bench at the south end of the park. Julia gave her a sidelong glance and hurried on her way. But every day after that, the young woman was sitting on the bench when Julia passed. Days turned into weeks and months, spring into summer. August that year was the hottest New York City had known since the turn of the century. Julia was embarrassed by the rings of sweat staining her blouse under the arms. She walked slower than usual, trying to prevent the stain from spreading. She wondered how the young woman was coping. And there she was, looking as cool as if it were September. The top two buttons of her blouse were undone, discreetly revealing the flesh above her breasts and the deep, dark color of a mole resting against the white of her skin. Afraid she would be caught staring, and despite the heat, Julia continued quickly across the park, not slowing until she passed under the arch and onto the sidewalk at the south end. All day at work, Julia thought only of that mole. She could not erase it from her mind's eye. Three times she had to unravel the thread and re-sew the ribbons on Mrs. Haverstam's new hat. Julia decided she must avoid the park for the rest of the summer. For the rest of the month, Julia left for work earlier than usual to allow the extra time to walk around the park. But still, she thought of the mole. She even dreamt of it at night. In her dream, she had this overwhelming urge to keep unbuttoning the woman's blouse, to look for more. While moving her other hand inside, like an explorer searching the larger elevations that rise majestically with peaks that harden to the touch, while she explored farther, entering the forest and the valleys between the thighs, and Julia awoke in a state of ecstasy and despair, wishing she could fall asleep again and finish the dream. Finally, September arrived, bringing the first cool day to warn of autumn's nearness. Julia put a sweater over her blouse and decided it was safe to walk through Washington Square once again. She entered the park and saw the young woman sitting on a bench near the arch. Though she was covered to her neck, Julia imagined the mole resting on the woman's bosom where she herself had dreamt of resting. The woman looked up at Julia. This time, Julia looked into those deep, dark eyes. The woman smiled and nodded. Julia smiled in return, and her life changed forever.